Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, a closer look at the president's pick for the U.S. Supreme Court. Also tonight, we'll look at legal issues regarding e-commerce on Indian land. And we'll learn about the struggles of getting electrical power on the Navajo Reservation. Those stories next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. President Trump picks U.S. Appeals Court Judge Neil Gorsuch to replace the late Antonin Scalia on the U.S. Supreme Court. Arizona Congressman Andy Biggs, a Republican, and Democrat Ruben Gallego weigh in on the president's choice.
In his capacity as a circuit court judge, he's been excellent. He's written excellent opinions. One of the marks of a genius, somebody who's really brilliant, is you're able to take complex issues and communicate those to people in a broad way. And his opinions read like that. He's obviously very brilliant on the law, but he's also a very cogent, very literate writer. And I think he's going to make an excellent Supreme Court justice.
Well, I'm advocating for the Senate to filibuster, I think for many reasons, but most importantly, just because Trump, number one, is not a normal president. This issue of Donald Trump, about what an unqualified president he is and how he's already acting in a very authoritarian manner that I think is very dangerous for democracy.
And here now to talk about the selection of Neil Gorsuch is ASU law professor Paul Bender and attorney James Goodnow of Fenimore Craig. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining
us.
Who is Neil Gorsuch?
A court of appeals judge.
Yeah. Colorado, Western guy.
It's interesting because the court has not had, court used to be really into geographical diversity. There were people from all over the country. That hasn't been true recently. It's only one person from west of the Mississippi, which is Kennedy. And so he does add geographical diversity and religious diversity because he will be the only Protestant on the court. More importantly about this, I think people have got to realize that Gorsuch, no matter what he's like, is not going to make any fast changes in the court. He won't have any real impact on Supreme Court decisions this year at all, because by the time the confirmation is over, the court will have heard almost all the cases it's going to decide, and he can't vote on a case unless he hears it. So he'll start in next term, and even when he's on the court, even if he's the exact clone of Scalia, the court will go back to the way it was before Scalia died. So there won't be any big change. The big change would come with the next
one. Okay, I want to get back to the idea of him being a Scalia light. But as I mentioned, Western from Colorado, and yet Oxford, Columbia, Harvard. Are you surprised that President Trump went Ivy League?
No, not when it comes to Gorsuch. So certainly on the campaign trail, Donald Trump was saying, look, we need to have a common man on the Supreme Court, but we also heard from him time and time again that he wants to have someone in the mold of Justice Scalia. So we know here that based on at least the comments that Judge Gorsuch has made, that he follows some of those same principles. Now, we can have a debate as to whether or not those played out actually in his opinions, but he has embraced the concept of originalism and textualism, which were hallmarks of Scalia opinions.
Define originalism and textualism.
Well, I have a great professor here who can do that, but originalism is the idea that you go back to the time that the Constitution was adopted and you look at what would people perceive the laws to be at that time. Textualism, simply looking at the text of the law in question and not looking at legislative intent.
That sounds like Scalia, doesn't it?
When you read his opinions, you would not think you're reading Scalia's opinions. They're completely different in approach and, I think, in analysis. His tone is very moderate, very calm, the exact opposite of Scalia, who will always tell you the world is coming to an end when he disagrees with what the court is doing. Gorsuch is very low-key, he's very analytical, and he has what seem to me to be human values. He cares about the effect of what he does on people. Very hard to find that in Scalia decisions. So it may be that his jurisprudence is like Scalia's, I really can't tell. But when you read his opinions, you don't get the kind of stuff you got from Scalia. Was original is the only way to go. The Supreme Court's gone clearly on the wrong track with doing this and doing that. He's not that kind of person. He's a person who I think will try to follow precedent, will try to be analytical and reasonable.
I saw an interesting quote from Judge Gorsuch. Congress writes laws, not judges. And he was saying a judge who likes every outcome he reaches is not a good judge. What does that mean?
If you don't, well, that means you're interpreting the law. You're not making the law. So Judge Gorsuch, like Justice Scalia, is someone who's opposed to judicial activism. And that's the concept that judges will come on and essentially legislate from the bench. And particularly when it comes to these hot button social issues. So he has a more modest view of the court, according to some. I think if you talk to progressives, though, they'll tell you, no, that's just a thinly veiled way of disguising your own sort of activism.
This quote again, a judge who likes every outcome he reaches is very likely a bad judge.
Yeah, I think I understand what he's saying, and I think it's the right thing to say, because you shouldn't care that much about the outcome. You should be prepared to reach outcomes that you wouldn't reach if you were in the legislature, because you're not. You're a judge. It would be hard for me to think of any outcome Scalia reached that he didn't like. Scalia always seemed to be 100% enthusiastic about everything he did. That's another thing about Gorsuch. He's very moderate. He said, this is a hard case. This on this side and on this side. You never saw that in Scalia.
So once he gets to hear cases and once he becomes a factor, it may take a while, as you mentioned. But once this happens, does he basically sit in the seat that Scalia sat in, and now Anthony Kennedy is still is even more so the wild card?
It's really returning to where we were a year ago. There's no doubt about that. So that's really what puts Democrats in a tough position. So now the question is, do they really want to fight? Clearly, it sounds from what we are hearing in reports that there will be filibuster attempts. So that means 60 votes are necessary. Boy, how far do you want to push that? Because if, in fact, the Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell invokes what's called the nuclear option, which is changing it to where it's not 60 votes, but a simple majority that's required. That means in the future, that same simple majority will apply, and you may get much more conservative justices. So I think Senate Democrats are walking a very, very fine line in terms of how they play this.
As far as the Supreme Court is concerned, again, we've talked many times about how Justice Kennedy, it's basically his court.
And it still will be after Gorsuch takes. He's right in the middle. I would think Gorsuch as a judge would be closest to Chief Justice Roberts on the court. To me, he seems to resemble that. Very conservative, very calm, narrow decisions when possible, maybe occasionally broader ones, but not somebody to stir things up, but somebody to calm things down.
Is this the kind, it's hard to project something like this, but could this be someone who changes once he's on the bench?
I was thinking about that. I was saying, do we have Justice Blackmun here? Because Justice Blackmun is very much like him when he came on the court. Very conservative, but he had human values. He had been a counsel for the Mayo Clinic. He's seen a lot of stuff like that. And he changed a lot while he was on the court. I think Gorsuch has that possibility.
Do you agree with Paul, the idea that Democrats, you better accept Gorsuch now because the next one down the line, that's going to be the real tough one for Democrats?
On balance, I think yes. I think right now there's a lot of emotion at stake. So clearly you have this opinion that this particular nomination was hijacked from Barack Obama. It's a stolen nomination. You have emotion coming from a presidency where you have someone who didn't get the majority of the popular vote. And of course, you have everything that's happened in the last 2 weeks with all of these executive orders. So emotions are high, and Senate Democrats are feeling the pressure from their base. We want you to fight this. But I think if you step back and look at this objectively, that may not be the right play.
The idea that, President Obama, we went, 10 months with that?
That was outrageous.
Does that taint this appointment?
It shouldn't. It's not Gorsuch's fault. It's not even Trump's fault. The Senate should never have done that. Garland was a wonderful appointment to the court, very much in the mode of what I hope Gorsuch will turn out to be, a moderate, somebody who gets along, who tries to bring people together, who talks moderately and reasonably to people. It was terrible. Now, he would have been a great thing for the court, but that was wrong. But you don't take that out now on what's happening. You don't do a second wrong thing because of the wrong thing that the Senate did before.
Do you agree with that? And again, the idea that for many in the country, I mean, many on the left, that this appointment will be forever tainted because of the background.
I think for some people, you just simply cannot change their mind on that. they will believe that. But I do agree, two wrongs don't make a right here. I think Trump, for all the problems he had with the rollouts in the first 2 weeks, he got this one right. This is something where you go back to September. That's really the first time that Trump floated Judge Gorsuch's name. So there's been a lot of vetting on this. And as it got closer, that name leaked out. So people were putting more scrutiny on Judge Gorsuch. And then he had a pretty good rollout from an optics standpoint. So I think right now, once the passions calm a bit, you will see the Democrats, at least eight of them, move over to support Judge Gorsuch.
And just be careful if you're thinking he's Scalia light.
That's not fair to him. He's himself.
All right. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
And coming up, we'll examine the unique legal challenges for American Indians looking to get into e-commerce on tribal land.
Watch sneak previews of what's coming soon. Go to azpbs.org/previews today.
American Indian tribes are increasingly doing business over the internet, which can result in conflicts between state, federal, and tribal laws. For more on this, we're joined by National Congress of American Indians Chairman Brian Cladsby and Robert Miller, Faculty Director of the Rosette LLP Native American Economic Development Program at ASU's Indian Legal Program. Good to have you both here.
Thank you so much
for joining
us. Great to be here.
Thank you.
Issues with tribes doing business on the internet. What are we talking about here?
Well, once again, the tribes are slowly getting into the 21st century when it comes to not only e-commerce, but economic development. And for example, just last week, NCAI partnered with the Gila River, Gila Indian community, Gila here in Arizona, to forward comments to the FCC in regards to the CenturyLink merger. And part of the issue that we have is affordable IP broadband access in Indian country right now. This merger affects 14 states and approximately 150 tribes, which represents 25% or more of the tribes in the U.S. So, you know, this is very important to us.
Yeah, indeed. And but as far as conflicts between state, federal, tribal law, a lot of it going on, or is it just enough to make a difference?
Well, I think there's a lot of it going on. I mean, there's competition over money, and that always gets overlooked. Even with Indian gaming, states are often fighting for that dollar, and they're worried that business is going elsewhere. Indian country, which is the poorest part of the United States, most people forget that American Indians, as a racial or ethnic group, are by far the poorest people in the United States, even with some of these very successful casinos. So tribes are looking, as the chairman said, for alternate opportunities and for creating economies on reservations. So there is competition because of law, infrastructure, and the issue he just mentioned is a classic.
You got that competition. What about jurisdictional complexities? Talk to us about that.
Well, once again, tribes are sovereign nations. And unfortunately, throughout the history of the U.S., the federal government has had a paternalistic attitude towards tribes where they think they know what's best for us. And we are slowly working with the federal government to, especially when it comes to economic development and e-commerce, to be able to slowly look at that low-hanging fruit of the regulations that have been in place for 100 to 150 years that basically stifles us. And it treats us as a government a little different than maybe a city or a county or a state government.
How are those communications going?
Interestingly, I thought what you were going to ask me was the same question.
Sorry. No, that's all right. Go ahead.
The competition is also about where this business takes place. So some tribes have been trying to do online gaming, and so the feds and the states are very concerned about that. Some tribes have gotten into the online lending, and they're trying to prove that it's occurring on reservation because the phone servers, the computers, the tribal government, or the tribal business is there. And yet states have been pushing back, and there are lawsuits going on around the country now about where is this lending or online gaming really occurring, and is it legal? So there's very much a jurisdictional legal fight that both the feds, the tribes, and the states are involved in.
And the possible implications for tribal sovereignty. I mean, you mentioned this earlier. I mean, that is a big factor, is it not?
The Supreme Court has often said that tribal governmental power and sovereignty is just within their own territory. So that's a drawback or a problem for a tribe that's trying to engage in sovereign-type businesses over the internet. Where is gaming really occurring? Is it at the home of the player or where the tribal infrastructure and the tribal government is?
And you mentioned communication regarding these jurisdictional boundaries. Is that communication happening? Is it improving?
Well, it is different across the nation. There's 567 tribal nations across the U.S., and some of them have an excellent working relationship with their local county and state governments, and others don't. And in the last 8 years, working with the Obama administration, the FCC, and from that standpoint, we've had a great working relationship, and we just hope that it'll continue with the Trump administration.
Yeah, you mentioned the Obama administration. We now have the Trump administration. What are you expecting? There's a very changed political landscape out there.
Many tribes have worked very well with Republican administrations. Richard Nixon is considered the father almost of what the current era we live in of self-determination. I think people often say that the Dems provide more money, the Rs provide better ideas. So I think a lot of tribal people are thinking there's more business to be done, and let's try to work with this administration from a pro-business economic activity situation. In my opinion, sir, economic activity is the most important issue that reservation communities and tribal governments face. We are the poorest of the poor, and it's hard to have any functioning economy and a community without some economic activity.
Agree with that?
Yes. When you look at the conservative values of a Republican, I mean, those are the same values that we have. Small government, less regulations, from the ground up opportunities, and they see the need to start whittling away at this paternalistic attitude that the federal government has had. And when you look at our issues, our tribal issues, they're pretty much nonpartisan. And so, for an example, we had a bill passed here 2 years ago in Congress. It was the General Welfare Exclusion Act dealing with taxation on Indian reservations by the IRS. You won't hear about this in the mainstream news, but we had 100% of Republicans and Democrats in the House and the Senate support this. So that's a good example of us being able to work with the Congress and the administration to get things passed that are pro-tribal and that are nonpartisan.
So with this in mind, the biggest challenge in terms of e-commerce and tribal sovereignty, what do you see? What's the biggest issue?
It's money, it's infrastructure, and it's human capital and capital, that we, as we normally think of that as money. Indian country, as I said, is the poorest of the poor. Some reservations still do not have broadband access. A tribe in Central Oregon only got broadband in 2012, and here it's 2 hours from Portland, Oregon.
Right.
So this type of business wasn't even available in some places. And then it's, does the tribe have the infrastructure, the governmental ability to conduct this, whatever business it is, whatever business it might be, we need it.
And there are cyber risks on Indian country, is there not? I mean, considering the mishmash of laws, you got to watch yourself.
Definitely. This last election proves, with the hacking of the DNC and the hacking of candidate Clinton's chief of staff. So yes, it's definitely something that tribes have to be aware of, that they have to have definitely strong security measures in place. And when you talk about infrastructure, and I'll do a little lead-in for your next story. I was out on the Navajo Indian Reservation and visiting some friends, and there's big power lines going through their homelands, but the houses still don't have electricity right there.
Yes.
And so that's one of the infrastructure concerns that, you know, we'll be looking forward to. And with the Trump administration, he wants to do $1 billion in infrastructure spending in the U.S., and nobody has more needs than Indian country. And broadband is another good example of what we need to really make e-commerce effective in tribal country.
And we should mention the conference regarding this will be, I believe, tomorrow, Wild Horse Pass Hotel and Casino.
It's
correct?
Our third annual e-commerce conference. We have 175 people coming, tribal leaders from all around the country, because yes, tribes are looking to diversify their economies, and if they can take advantage of e-commerce, that's a win-win situation.
Good to have you both here.
Thanks
for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Why in the world are people living without modern-day electricity? It's the res realities because of the distances.
When we pass through a certain area of Navajo, there's high voltage lines that you can see from the road, and right below them you'll see a traditional Navajo hogan. But yet it's kind of ironic that we have electricity generated with Navajo resources that's going to power major metropolitan areas, and there's this little hogan with a family that is not going to be getting any power.
I often wonder, you know, how much we had lost our natural resources going out and delivering power elsewhere. Nothing came back onto the reservation.
Navajo Nation is a battery for the Southwest, and our reservation actually has air pollution that's similar to the city of Denver, Colorado. Where's all this pollution coming from? Because we don't live in a city. We're not actually using a lot of energy as individual Navajo citizens on the reservation. So the obvious culprit is the power plants and extraction sites. We're surrounded by, either on our reservation or around it, 7 coal-fired power plants. And the 3 that have existed on our reservation are the 3 biggest power plants in the West.
I guess in a sense, we took it for granted that they were meant to actually grow the Navajo Nation. The reason why they are not connected to the grid is because of the amount of costs, really.
It's $35,000 per mile to extend the grid, but that's out of the pocket of the individual. I don't know about you, but I don't have that kind of money laying around to be able to put in electricity.
My grandmother, I was hoping that she would get utility services before she had passed, because that was my commitment, was to serve those type of people. So they did not have the opportunity. So I was kind of a little bit bummed by it that they weren't able to experience it.
And so the unique solution was using solar and off-grid systems to then give them electricity.
And I've been having a solar system for probably like a good 5 years now. My daughter's medicine, that's how we got the solar too. So we use that to keep it cool.
So there's a direct tie now from health of a population to the use of electricity, particularly for refrigeration.
Electricity from the solar panels are very limited. We can't use all the appliances all together, all at once. We can't use them for long periods of time.
Before the sun goes down, we have to turn off certain devices, like maybe the lights. We can use only 1 or 2 lights.
And so at some point we have to have a compromise of how to use the system so that we supply the right amount for them.
But I think it comes down to cost. What's affordable to people? And so you gotta balance that electrical appetite, the need for energy, versus how much people can afford.
This one I only pay about $105 a month. and it doesn't fluctuate. It's just the same payment.
It's really great to see customers when they get utility services for the first time. You'll see that children, even people just running around through their homes, turning on all the lights to see if it all works.
I was excited the first day, to tell you the truth.
How did it feel to get electricity for the first time? It felt different. Matter of fact, we weren't really accustomed to it, so we still used a flashlight, even though we had a flip of a switch to turn on the light.
Sometimes people say, why doesn't she just move? And you have to really understand, that's just such a naive thing to think about. This woman has lived there her whole life, and she wants to live there. That's her choice.
We're out here where nature rules, and we comply. The sun is what it is, the earth is what it is, what it brings. On any given day, we'll accept, we'll receive with appreciation. It's nature taking care of us, the earth and the sun, in this very, very beautiful place we call home.
That story from Courtney Columbus, Catherine Mueller, Brittany Nixon, and Lisa Marie Schlesinger. And by last count, more than 200 solar units have been placed at remote home sites on the reservation. Thursday on Arizona Horizon, it's Phoenix Open Week. We'll get to know Golf Channel analyst, best-selling author, and Scottsdale resident Brandel Chambly. A special in-focus edition on the next Arizona Horizon. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.